It's 3 a.m. Pietro, go to sleep. Piera turned over in bed, trying to stay calm. She was used to waking up in the middle of the night because of war nightmares, but also because of her husband, who often worked until the wee hours. Since their return to Alba in 1942, Pietro had been keeping the light on in his laboratory, defying the bombs. He wanted to leave behind the disappointment of the pastry shop he had closed in Turin. But really for him, creating was the only antidote to the violence that surrounded them. During the day, as he sleepily walked the town with his white chef's jacket, he elicited suppressed smiles from everyone, but Piera let him go on. Perhaps it was out of pity for him that both partisans and fascists had spared the pastry shop she ran in Via Maestra. "Try this, Piera," her husband insisted, holding out another chocolate paste. With him, this time, was their son Michele, who had just returned home after completing his studies. And this time, she could foresee that Pietro had something really new. She was aware that a few days before, his brother Giovanni had brought Pietro molasses to help him mix ground hazelnuts, leftovers from beet scraps that some local bakers had given him as a gift for delivering fresh yeast. Filled with hope, she tasted the chocolate. "This is good," she smiled with surprise, looking at her son, who was also licking his lips. "Dad, it's delicious," he said, as Pietro seemed to be lost in thought. That was the recipe he had been looking for, and he was probably pondering the years he spent in search for it. Then he suddenly changed expression while Piera continued reading his mind. Surely he was already thinking about how to sell it to their customers, how to plant as many hazelnut trees as possible, how to... She was familiar with his restless genius. Like every creator, he craved nothing less than to love and be loved, to share his passion and be appreciated for it. He had always been like this since the time they had met in her hometown of Dogliani 20 years before. She was walking by the pastry shop where he was apprenticing and saw a wonderful cake celebrating the birthday of Rome, a new feast which Mussolini had established in 1923, which Fellini also portrayed in the fascist parade in his movie Amarcord. She had met Pietro through his pastry sweets and married him the following year. In 1925, their only son Michele was born in Dogliani, and immediately afterward, the three of them moved to Alba. They remained there until 1934, when Pietro decided to open his own pastry shop in Turin. Driven by the entrepreneurial spirit of his brother Giovanni, who had previously started a wholesale business of confectionery products and brewer's yeast, Piera followed him to the big city, entrusting Michele's education to the boarding school of the Somaschi fathers in Cherasco and to the care of her priest brother Eugenio. In Turin, Pietro perfected the technique of the Giandujot, the mix of cocoa and hazelnut invented by Caffarel, but incurred financial difficulties as the fascist regime imposed increasingly dire limitations on cocoa imports. To overcome these hardships, or perhaps to seize what he perceived as an opportunity for growth, he decided to move to East Africa in 1938 to sell panettone cakes to the Italian colonial army stationed in Ethiopia. This adventure did not last long, however, and in 1940 he returned to Turin and opened a new pastry shop in Via Sant'Anselmo. As the war forced them to close the shop, they returned to Alba in 1942. Where Piera ran a small store in Via Maestra to support the family. Now, between 1943 and 1945, the Langhe region was a key battlefield, and Alba became the center of a dramatic civil war. On October 10th, 1944, as partisans freed it from fascist control, Alba became the first liberated city in northern Italy, though for only 23 days. This time would be transfigured by local writer Beppe Fenoglio in his famous novel I 23 giorni della città di Alba. Throughout the war, Piera had always been with Pietro. She was in the store while he searched for an original recipe in his laboratory to redeem his failures. She was in the store when the partisan troops paraded through Via Maestra, liberating the city. She was in the store after the war, offering through sweets a simple but concrete commitment to the rebirth of civil coexistence. She was there to balance Pietro's creative dreams and warmly welcome their son Michele home after his wartime school years. She observed the needs of people and kept the numbers in check with both pragmatism and warmth. As she saw Pietro transform a limit into a resource, the scarcity of cocoa into a stimulus for an original solution, she helped him grow a strategic outlook for his hazelnut paste and planned the steps for its commercial development. As rumors spread that Pietro Ferrero had found a delicious recipe, they started producing and selling it at the pastry shop, packing the Giandujot paste in aluminum foil to carry out. Its success mainly related to its limited cost, versatility, and portability. The Giandujot was in fact easily packable and cuttable, and offered to workers a cheaper alternative to a bread and tomato lunch, and to children an inexpensive and tasty snack. Because of its connection to Turin's hazelnut chocolate, Giandujotto, and the city's carnival mask, Giandujot, the new product took the name of Giandujot and rapidly sold in local bars, schools, and orphanages. The request for Giandujot became so pressing that the Ferrero laboratory soon began to look for employees. To keep up with demand, the Ferrero pastry shop hired 5 workers at a time when the only job available in the city was that of city cleaner. We see a similar situation in De Sica's Bicycle Thieves, whose plot revolves around the story of Antonio Ricci and his stolen bicycle, which he had acquired, pawning his wife's dowry, to accept the only available job in town, pasting ad posters on municipal walls. A year after the war ended, the overwhelming growth of the Giandujot forced Pietro to think even bigger. After setting up a larger factory for wholesale production on May 14, 1946, Pietro and his brother Giovanni established the Ferrero industry. In the first 2 years, the company quickly moved from 200 to 2,000 employees. Its driving force was a dynamic synthesis of Pietro's rebuilding urgency and his wife Piera's entrepreneurial vision. After founding the factory, the couple organized buses to transport their employees to and from work, funded daycares and a professional school for their children, donated a fountain to the city, and created the Ferrero Village as a space for education. Piera used to go to the factory an hour before the start of the workday to prepare coffee for the workers and welcome them in person in the morning. She also persuaded her husband to give employees time off during the harvest and encourage them to plant hazelnut trees. This way, she nourished their connection to the land and became a personalizing factor in their transition from agriculture to industry. Her attention to the well-being of workers, her care for nature, and her concern for the quality of the product, despite the scarcity of the reconstruction years, is still at the root of Ferrero's entrepreneurial mission. It is in this context that Michele Ferrero began to participate in the family business, transitioning from post-war apprenticeship with his father to a mature partnership. It is in dialogue with his artistic sense, his uncle's ability as a salesman, and his mother's strategic vision that Michele developed a two-lung company intended as both an economic and social value creator. Ferrero thus became a symbol of post-war reconstruction, promoting a new model of industrial growth and social reconciliation. 2 years after its foundation, however, the company suddenly found itself on the verge of collapse. On September 4, 1948, the Tanaro River flooded the facilities, covering them with mud, and only the dedication of the employees in shoveling out debris saved Ferrero, as would also be the case in 1994. 6 months later, on March 2, 1949, Pietro Ferrero died of a heart attack at age 51, as would be the case for his grandson Pietro in 2011. It was then that Piera, her brother-in-law Giovanni, and her son Michele took over the company, laying the groundwork for its extraordinary ascent in the following years. Over the subsequent decades, Michele Ferrero perfected the recipe of his father's Giandujot, modifying it into a chocolate spread and branding it with the unforgettable name of Nutella in 1964. At the same time, after the sudden death of his uncle Giovanni in 1957, he took over full responsibility for the business. Unlike his uncle, who aimed at solidifying sales in Italy, Michele pioneered the expansion of the company abroad, opening the first facility in Germany on a former weapons manufacturing site, and later moved its headquarters from Alba to Turin. Throughout these developments, his mother, Piera, was a solid point of reference for the company's cultural and economic growth. Harkening back to the post-war years, she became the inspiration for the Villa Piera, a campus established in the surroundings of the new German factory, offering services, schooling, and transportation for Ferrero workers. As her son Michele became CEO, Piera Cillario became the president of Ferrero in 1962. She would hold this position until her death in 1980. Her legacy continues in the professional institute that Alba named after her in 1987, and most importantly, in the Ferrero Foundation, which Michele Ferrero established in her honor in 1983. The foundation's motto, Lavorare, Creare, Donare, to work, create, and give, pays homage to his parents and exemplifies his mother's particular attention to workers even after their retirement, as the institution provides them with cultural activities, health services, and a lively community. These are still the founding values of the company, which has now become an international holding in the confectionery sector. Ferrero could have been a forgotten story of failure and post-war distress. Pietro's recipe could have been lost in the wake of two unforeseen tragedies. Michele's path could have taken a completely different direction, and yet the company found its way back, became a successful story of resilience and rebirth, and maintained its core values intact throughout the decades. Without the pragmatic love of Piera, without her silent accompaniment of Michele, without her relentless commitment to workers and their well-being, we would not be talking about the chocolate factory of Alba in the same terms. Sometimes an innovator does not need the spotlight. Sometimes an innovator is someone who has the gift to continuously generate stories, even without being seen, like the great mothers, like the authors of the greatest stories ever told. Thank you very much for watching. If you like this presentation, I invite you to subscribe to this YouTube channel or to the webpage www.italianinnovators.com to receive notifications on new episodes. You can also follow me on my LinkedIn profile or on Instagram at Italian Innovators for additional materials about the show. Thanks again. Arrivederci e alla prossima!